listening to the Sports Ferret on Academy FM.
Good morning, sport lovers of Folkestone. This is Kevin Daly, the Sports Ferret on Academy 105.9, with another hour of sporty stuff from the Folkestone area. Today we've got reports on football, road running, boxing, rugby, hockey, and news about the new urban sports centre proposal just up the road here in Tontine Street. We're joined by two special guests, Herbie Tyler from the Kent F.A., whose job it is to promote football in the Shepway area, and Folkestone mum Debbie Maynard, who in a few weeks' time will be running the Brighton Marathon, raising money for Bloodwise, the leukemia charity. But first, an Academy FM tribute to the brilliant Sir George Martin, who passed away during the week. He was a producer of many, many Beatles songs and absolutely, literally hundreds of other songs. If you Wikipedia George Martin, you just realise how many songs he produced. So this song's also got a sporty connection. I'll tell you about it afterwards. But first of all, let's have a little bit of Penny Lane.
Penny Lane, there is a barber showing photographs.
Now, the sporty story. That song was dedicated to Malcolm and Julie Gibbs. Now, they can't hear us, but I'm sure they will get a recording. I'm going to get a recording of this to them. Now, Malcolm and Julie from Folkestone, they belong to the Folkestone Running Club. And tomorrow, they are running in the Liverpool Half Marathon. Now, while they're up there, they hope to take in the Beatles tour, which visits two known places in Liverpool, Penny Lane and Strawberry Fields. So I had a toss-up, really. I was really wanted to play one of these songs, and I put a bit on Facebook, and Penny Lane seemed to be the more popular. Now, Beatle fans will know these two famous songs, of course, but they are actually two places that do exist. Penny Lane was, in fact, a bus terminus up in Liverpool. All the buses used to have, like, a big plaque on the front of the bus, Penny Lane. And Strawberry Fields was the name of a Salvation Army children's home, which John Lennon used to play in as a kid. So there you go, a bit of sporty trivia with that Liverpool connection there. Right, let's move on to something a bit more local. Now, I want to say good morning to our two guests. Good morning to Herbie Tyler. Morning, Herbie.
Hello, mate. You all right?
How are you? All right?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so you popped in. You've given up a bit of your time this morning, but you're going to tell us how things are going in Shepway Sports football-wise. But you've got to dash off. Why have you got to dash off?
Oh, Mind and I's got a tournament in Margate. So got semi-final.
Semi-final in Margate for under nines.
Under nines, yeah. It's one of the many teams involved in, yeah.
Okay, well, we're going to come back to you, but we're going to say good morning to Debbie. Morning, Debbie.
Morning, Kev.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Good. Now, you're in here today because in a few weeks' time, you're going to be running the Brighton Marathon, is that right?
That's right, 37 days to be exact.
Oh, you're counting, are you?
Yes.
Yeah. Hang on, I'm looking at the clock, it's 10 past, so yeah, it's 37 days. Now, we did hope to get your two running buddies in today, So we're going to say good morning to them.
Morning, Claire, and morning, Chantelle. Hope you're doing okay, Claire. Claire's currently running 20 miles today, and Chantelle and I will be doing that tomorrow.
Oh, okay, something to look forward to.
Yeah.
Okay, now, Debbie, sit tight. We're going to speak to Herbie for a little while, and then we're going to come back to you. We're going to talk football now. Now, Herbie, a couple of years ago, you came in to Academy, and I can't remember at what stage you were, but you were just becoming an apprentice with the Kent F.A., is that right?
Yeah, definitely. So I just started an apprenticeship with Kent F.A. doing football development. I was studying sport development at college as well. It's gone well. I've come out the other end of it now, and offered a full-time job.
You're employed by the Kent F.A. now?
Yeah.
And so what is your kind of mission statement? What do you have to do in Shepway?
It's the same as I have to do across the county. Basically, I'm in charge of recreational football, so increasing adult participation specifically. It's that casual dropping and play, just getting people off the sofa and kicking the ball around, really, and seeing how we can maybe help them go into a competitive team from that.
So you're basically a Shepway lad, so obviously your heart is in Shepway, but you have to cover the rest of the county as well?
Yeah, I'm guilty of doing a bit too much work down here because it's...
Do you?
Yeah. Yeah, because obviously it is close to home. But we've got some really, really good projects, and we work with some great partners across the county. It's going really well.
Okay, now I've noticed that these little football tournaments have been popping up, and I think that's to do with you. I've noticed that we've now got a Dad's League.
Yes.
a business league and possibly an under-21s league. Is that all you're doing?
is that all I'm doing? the under-21s, initially we were hoping to make it into a league, but we've actually turned it into a coached training session now. Right. So we have a lot of boys from the East Kent College come down and we offer them some decent coaching and they get to play football at the end of it as well. The Fathers League, obviously, it's for the dads of the local primary schools and teachers as well, so some members of staff can play. We've just had a really successful winter season with that. And the Business League as well, obviously for local industry. But we've also got a coaches team from Folks and Invicta. So,
a coaches team?
Yes.
Yeah, so when I saw this before, coaches team, I thought, they've got a load of players from Buzz Lines and Cross Keys and things like that. But explain to me what a coaches team is.
So obviously, in youth football, it's not just the players that give up their time. A lot of it, throughout the whole county and the country, football is run by volunteers. Coaches specifically, like myself, we give up a lot of time to be able to kind of provide football for kids, and it usually takes up a lot of time over the weekend. But that means that your kind of typical times that you'd play football are taken up by taking kids to tournaments and matches and that kind of thing.
Right.
So we decided that to re-engage some of the dads and coaches into football, we put a little team together and play on the Thursday evening.
I see.
So it's just about an opportunity, an alternative opportunity for people to play, which is kind of ties into all the work I'm trying to do.
Okay. Well, so going back a bit now to when you first came in, what sort of subjects were there involved when you did your apprenticeship? I mean, it's not just like, oh, there's the goal, let's put the ball in the back of the net. Obviously, there's much more to it. So,
sure. I mean, across the country, we're seeing this national trend where 11v11 adult male football is it's declining massively. I've kind of been put in place to do a bit of investigation, find out why footballers are dropping out from the game and what we can do to help it, especially in this area. Adult football is definitely on sort of the slide in the wrong direction. It's strange because youth football is spiking. So the numbers are going dramatically upwards until they hit the age of sort of like 16, and then they're dropping out. So recreational football is meant to be sort of a safety net to try and catch those players that are dropping out of the game, and seeing what we can do to try and get them playing again.
Okay, right. Well, we're going to play a bit of music now. This is really interesting, the fact that people are dropping out. When I was a lad, all I ever did was play football, yeah. You know, and every waking minute of the day, I had to get out and play football. And I'm surprised to hear that 16-year-olds are dropping out. And we're going to play a bit of music, and then we're going to try and find out why.
105.9 Academy FM.
Saturday Sport. You're listening to the Sports Ferret on Academy FM. Academy FM.
Don't Let Me Down. That was Naive by the Kooks. Now, Herbie was just telling me he went to see the Kooks, him and some of his listeners out there. Morning, listeners, who keep hashtagging in the Kooks. You went to see him the other day, is that right?
Yeah, a couple, well, sort of like 4 weeks ago, maybe, something like that. Went with my best mate, Ben.
Ben.
Morning,
Ben.
He's currently messaging me on Facebook, actually, live hashtags of all the things I'm saying.
Herbie, we were just saying before the last song that you find that there's 16-year-olds kind of ever drop out a little bit, drop out rate at football at that age?
Yeah, I mean, there's loads of reasons for it. We're doing a massive research project at the moment to try and find out more through University of Kent, doing a bit of correspondence with players and trying to find out reasons. But generally, we think the reasons are lifestyle change, that there's not sort of the value of money in the 11-a-side game anymore. And also the more convenient offers, sort of your 6-a-side offers, they can just turn up, play for an hour and leave. They don't have to give up hours of their time.
Right.
Also, a lot of young people, they work at the weekends, and all the football's at the weekend, so it clashes and they just naturally drop out. And there's sort of statistics that if they drop out, you know, if you get them within the first few months of them dropping out, they're 90% more likely to play. Whereas if you leave it a year, they're 90% more likely not to play.
Okay.
So the longer you leave it, so it's literally about trying to come up with an offer for those people, so that we can get them playing as soon as we can and try and feed them back into the game.
And there's more distractions for youngsters, isn't there, now? I mean, all right, so I played football for quite a while. But when I was 16, as we said earlier, all I wanted to do was play football. There was no Xbox, you know, there was TV, yeah. But it wasn't such a distraction, no mobile phones. All we wanted to do was get out and kick a ball. All right, we had to get up and do a paper round, you know, earn a bit of money. So I could understand. But I have noticed that when I came to Folkestone in the early 80s, there was the Sunday League was really big then. There were two divisions, some really good football. A lot of the local folks in Invicta standard of football players would play on a Sunday morning, but this doesn't happen now. So Herbie, it's your job to resurrect all this enthusiasm, is that right?
Definitely. Or just to find out what's going on, really. And,
yeah. But the facilities now are probably better than ever, aren't they? You've got the 3G pitch now, and the two other pitches there. Sadly, what I've noticed is we're lacking, as these 3G pitches are coming out, I've only got a look at the polo field now. Pitches down the bottom, you know, the grass pitches seem to be disappearing. Do you think that's had any effect on the way the game's gone?
I'm not so sure, because moving on to 3G, obviously you take away the fact that games are getting cancelled, that you turn up, you get absolutely caped in mud, or you're always playing on a high quality surface. So for youth football especially, they've got a bit of a luxury there. I mean it's harder for teams to find pitches now.
Yeah,
definitely. But I mean, us as an organisation, we're doing a lot of work working with local authorities to find
some pitches. Really,
well, not even that, just to kind of make sure they're not building on them. Yeah, or when there's a big building development going on, working with the planners to make sure that some green space is included, whether we can put some football pitches on there.
Right.
I mean, obviously, we've had the closure of Church Road locally. But I mean, the 3G offers you football 24/7. You can't get that from a grass pitch. If you play one game on a grass pitch, that's it for the day. You can't get another game on there. Whereas 3G can have rolling fixtures for hours and hours and hours, and you could go from 9 o'clock in the morning to 9 o'clock at night.
It is a benefit in that respect. I think that's why the under-18s league for Folkestone and the under-18s Premier League, I think they suffer. Because I think part of the deal is if you're in that league, they want you to play on the main pitch of the club, like Invicta, Herne Bay, Ramsgate, Margate. But I mean, if the pitches are suffering and and the teams like Folkestone are going for promotion, they don't really want their pitch ruined, do they?
No, I can understand that. But I think part of the commitment of having youth teams is that you have to do a bit of that. It's about making sure that you've got the right funding and support to be able to maintain your pitch. Clubs like Folkestone are lucky that they've got volunteers that so actively spend so much time on the pitch.
Folkestone and Victor are really lucky, and we've said this before when we've been on air here about the volunteers up at Folkestone and Victor. Now we're going to play a little bit of music, then we're going to come back to Herbie, because Herbie's got to shoot off to cheer his under nines on in a semi-final. So we're going to have a little bit of Diana Ross. Okay, we're just having a little chat off there. They nearly got caught out. That was Diana Ross from 1965. Okay, now we're going to have our last little chat with Herbie because he's got to fly off. I was just trying to read all the messages on his phone. Morning, fellas. Lots of hashtags out there. So, Herbie, now it's your last chance to get your word across. So, have you got any exciting projects coming up that we need to talk about and tell the people of Shepway to get involved in?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we... Obviously, I coach with Gillingham Football Club as well. So,
oh, do you? Yes, I did pick up on that. You've got your other hat, isn't it?
One of my many.
Yes.
So we run a development centre for under 8s and under 9s currently. And that's really, really successful. We've got about 26 kids signed on. Right. But of that, I think two have gone on to the advanced development centre, two have been offered trials and another one's been offered training. So, you know, the local players are getting really good opportunities to go on and get coached at a professional football club. And we're actually looking at expanding that now.
Right. So I mean, when's this happening? Parents think, you know, like, oh, this sounds really exciting, how can they get in touch with you?
The best bet is to try and get in contact with the club.
What, Gillingham?
Yeah. So the Priestley Stadium has a general number. I don't have it on
me.
No,
that's all right. No,
but it's easy to find on Google. And they, if they ask to speak to Barry Cooper, he's the local contact for that. And we're looking to go into under-10s football and under-11s football now, because we've had such success with the younger age group as well. And we're holding a big trials day. So right. that's going to be on the 13th of April.
13th of April,
so,
right.
So I believe that's from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock on the 3G at Three Hills.
Right.
And that is a chance for people to come in, all these kids to come and get a bit of coaching on the day. So even if they're not kind of chosen to go into the development centre, they still get the opportunity to kind of have a really good fun football experience.
Right, okay, so this is sounding really exciting. What we were trying to do then is just get over this 16-year-old barrier, really, isn't it? Would that be one of your ambitions, to get the 16-year-olds back on the pitch?
Yeah, I think from my point of view, I like to try and think differently. I think if you don't change the offer to suit your customers, I hate the word customers, but kind of in the sense players are customers to football. But if you don't change the offer, then you'll lose kind of your customers.
Right. Okay.
From my point of view, I just want to think of something that's a bit unique and what works around people's lifestyles, so that we can change the game for the better.
Right. So if people want to just have a word with you, I mean, have you got a Facebook page? Is there any way they can kind of contact you, if you like, privately, without, you know, plastering everything all over the internet or social media? Can they get hold of you?
Yeah, sure. I mean, your best bet's to get me on my email, to be honest, my work email. So that's herbie.tyler@kentfa.com.
Okay, well, we'll post that up. I'll post that up on my Sportsferret page later on today. So, final word then, Herbie. Got any visions? What would you like to see? Oh, I'll tell you something else we do want to talk about very, very briefly. Talking about success stories. Now, you've got a little story about one of our former players, haven't you?
Yeah.
Go on.
So, I went to school with Johan, who obviously famously got signed by Hull City three years ago now?
Yeah, I think it was a 3-year contract at the time, but we've had some good news.
Yeah, so I saw the other day that he's got a contract extension, which is brilliant. So I was speaking to him the other day. He's over the moon. I think he's hoping for a loan move to go and get some good football experience out on the pitch to carry on his development. But it's really positive because, you know, the club have released a lot of players this season.
Have they? Yes.
And he's survived the cuts, I'd say. So, you know, it's, I think initially getting that 3 years, I think that's brilliant. It's a dream come true. But I think now the dream's becoming more real because he's been kept on.
I mean, obviously, if they are getting rid of players, then he must stand out, which he did down here. We knew he was a little star, but well done, Johan, for your contract extension. And we'll be reading more about your progress in the Invicta Forum, no doubt.
Yes, no doubt.
Okay, Herbie, look, thanks so much for coming in. I know you got a shoot off. Who's your opponents today in the under-9s?
There's multiple teams, to be honest.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. So,
Is it a competition today?
Yeah, it's like a little round robin tournament.
I see.
And then sort of the winner of that goes into a final where you play like a full length game. So,
brilliant. Yeah, okay, Herbie, your enthusiasm for the game is fantastic. I hope it rubs off on these guys at the 16-year-old age when they, you know, when we want them to stay in the game. Thanks so much for coming in, and it's great to hear that you've gone from apprentice to like ambassador, really, for the Kent FA, and we're really proud to have you working in this town promoting football. So good luck this afternoon, Herbie.
Thank you so much, mate.
Okay, cheers. All the best. Okay, now we're gonna play a bit of music now, and then we're going to go, this lovely lady in the waiting there. We've got Debbie, who's rearing to go talk about Brighton Marathon. So I think we're going to play a bit of Roxy music.
The Saturday Sports Show, brought to you by the Natural Health Centre in Folkestone. When it comes to your health, make the right choice.
105.9 Academy FM. 105.9 Academy FM.
Saturday Sport. You're listening to the Sports Ferret on Academy FM.